Hello friends, myself Devas Joshi, and friends, I once again welcome all of you in my YouTube channel. So friends, our today's topic is boiler indirect efficiency. As you can see from here, boiler indirect efficiency. So friends, today we will see how we can calculate the value of efficiency of boiler using indirect method. So friends, let's start our today's topic. So now friends, now we will have a look at the efficiency. So what is efficiency? Efficiency is nothing but the ratio of output to input multiplied by 100. And as you all are aware of that in any system, some losses are inevitable. So whatever the output you will receive is definitely going to be less than the input you have given. So accordingly, I can write this in a form of equation. And I can say input is equal to output plus losses. I can term it as equation 1. So I can rewrite this equation 1 and I can write it as output is equal to input minus losses. What I have done, I have shifted the losses from here to this side. Now I can rewrite the definition of this efficiency as efficiency is equal to input minus losses divided by input multiplied by 100. What I have done, I have substituted the value of output in this equation, or you can say in the ratio. So when I solve this, I will get input divided by input minus losses divided by input multiplied by 100, which can be solved as 1. As input and input will cancel out, 1 minus loss divided by input multiplied by 100, which I can finally write it as 100 minus loss percent. So you can say I have translated the definition of efficiency in the form of losses. So suppose there are 4 types of losses in my system. So I can write it as loss percent, that is the total loss percent, will be equal to L1%, that is the first loss, L2%, L3% and L4%. So ultimately my formula for the efficiency transforms into 100 minus L1% minus L2% minus L3% minus L4%. So this is the concept which I will use for calculation of efficiency of boiler using indirect method. So now looking at this, you must have realized that what I will try to do to calculate the efficiency of boiler using an indirect method. So now we will see how we will proceed. So friends, now for calculation of efficiency of boiler using indirect method, first we should know that what are the various losses that are bound to happen in a boiler, and then we can calculate the percentage for each of the losses. Then we can use the definition of efficiency which I have arrived in terms of losses, and thus we can calculate our boiler efficiency using indirect method. So friends, now we will see what are the various losses that are there in a boiler system. So friends, as you can see, the total heat losses that are there in a boiler can be divided into 8 losses, as you can see here. So the first one is the heat loss in dry flue gas. Second is the heat loss due to formation of water from hydrogen present in fuel. As I have already told you that the hydrogen present in fuel results in the formation of water. So the third loss is heat loss due to moisture in fuel. Again, the moisture in the fuel will result in the formation of water vapor. The fourth one is heat loss due to moisture in air. Again, the moisture present in air will result in the formation of water vapor. The fifth loss is heat loss due to partial conversion of carbon into carbon monoxide. As you all know that if the carbon is not getting converted into carbon dioxide due to poor supply of oxygen or air, you can say, then you have to sacrifice some of the energy that could have been generated if the carbon is getting itself converted to carbon dioxide. The next loss is heat loss due to convection, radiation and other unaccounted losses. So generally heat loss is bound to happen through convection, radiation, and there are many other factors that can also lead to some of the losses and which are taken care of in the form of unaccounted losses. Friends, the next loss is the heat loss due to unburnt in fly ash. The last one is the heat lost due to unburnt in bottom ash. So I have marked all the losses as L1 to L8. And if I have calculated the value of percentage of each of the losses, I can calculate the efficiency of boiler using the same formula which I have derived just before, and I can very easily calculate the efficiency of boiler as 100 minus the percentage loss because of heat loss in dry flue gas minus L2% minus L3%, and similarly I will go up to L8%. So as you have seen that once I get to know the value of each of these losses, I can calculate my efficiency of a boiler, and the calculation of boiler efficiency through this method is what is called as boiler indirect efficiency. So next we will consider each one of the losses in detail. The entire losses that are there in the boiler can be classified into 8 of these losses, and as per the question, whichever is applicable out of these 8, you have to consider only those losses. It is not like that you have to calculate each of the losses every time. As per the question, whichever loss is applicable, you have to calculate it, and accordingly you have to put only that one in this equation. So friends, now we will see how we can calculate the heat loss in dry flue gas, and I have considered this heat loss as L1. So friends, it must be clear that what is the heat input in case of a boiler. The heat input is the heat energy released by the fuel in the process of combustion. So you can easily see here, this is a combustion chamber, and in this combustion chamber fuel and air enters, combustion takes place, and the flue gas is released from the exhaust. So I have written here as dry flue gas. So friends, you must remember that for the sake of calculation of heat loss in dry flue gas, I have to consider only the dry part of this flue gas. As you can see that this flue gas can be break down into dry flue gas plus water or the moisture. For the loss as far as this water or moisture is concerned, it will be dealt separately in my subsequent part of the video. So here I am calculating the loss that is linked with this dry flue gas only. So accordingly I have written heat lost in dry flue gas. So as you can see, the heat input will be given in the form of heat that is released from the fuel itself. And you must remember that for calculation I have assumed 1 kg of fuel, and I have further assumed that for 1 kg of fuel, N kg of dry flue gas is getting formed. So friends, the value of this M can be calculated very easily. If you wish to know how we can calculate the value of this M, so do write in the comment section. I will try to prepare a separate video on how you can calculate the value of this M. So friends, here GCV is the gross calorific value of the fuel. CP is the specific heat of the dry flue gas which is getting formed as a result of this combustion. So friends, when the exhaust or the flue gas is leaving from this exhaust side, the temperature of the flue gas is TF. That is, at this point the flue gas is having the temperature at TF, and the ambient temperature, ultimately what will happen, the flue gas will ultimately flow to the atmosphere, and the temperature of atmosphere is the ambient temperature. Suppose this is TA.
So what will happen in this process? In this process, as the flue gas is moving from this point to the atmosphere, the temperature of the flue gas will reduce from TF to TA. So you can say, as the temperature is getting reduced, you all must be aware that temperature is linked with the heat content that is available in that substance. So as the temperature is reduced, the flue gas will keep on rejecting its heat to the atmosphere. So the heat which is rejected to the atmosphere, it is what we can say is the loss, because we are not utilizing that heat in some of our process, and that heat energy is ultimately getting released to the atmosphere. So you can see very clearly the amount of heat rejected to the atmosphere is ultimately absorbed from where? It has been absorbed in the combustion chamber from the energy which is released from the combustion of this fuel. So ultimately you can say that the energy of this fuel which has been released in the combustion chamber is getting released in the ambient space or the atmosphere because of the dry flue gas. Because ultimately you have to reject the dry flue gas so that the combustion become a continuous process. So as you all know that the basic formula for the rejection of heat is given as mass into specific heat into delta T, that is temperature difference. So the heat lost in dry flue gas, as it is getting its temperature reduction from TF to TA, can be written as M into Cp into TF minus TA. M is the mass of the dry flue gas that I have assumed will be formed from 1 kg of fuel. Cp is the specific heat of the dry flue gas. So you can easily see the heat lost in dry flue gas is M Cp TF minus TA. This is delta T. So I hope it is very clear how we derive this equation 1. Now, as we have seen that I have assumed 1 kg of fuel, and what is the GCV of the fuel? This GCV is the gross calorific value, and its unit is kilocalorie per kg. So energy input with 1 kg of fuel will be mass multiplied by GCV of the fuel. So it will be ultimately come as GCV. So from here you can easily see the L1 percentage, that is heat lost in dry flue gas, can be calculated as 1 divided by equation 2 multiplied by 100, that is M Cp TF minus TA divided by GCV multiplied by 100. So this is the loss percentage that is linked with the dry flue gas. So this is how this has been calculated. This has been given in the book directly as it is. Hope you will now be able to get the concept how this value is being calculated. So friends, before proceeding, I just want to make a correction that the specific heat of dry flue gas, that is Cp, if not given, then you have to consider it as 0.24, and if it is not given in the question, you have to assume it as 0.24 and not 0.45, because 0.45 is the specific heat of wet flue gas, or you can say water vapor, if not given. So now we will see our next loss that we have considered, heat lost due to formation of water from hydrogen present in fuel, and I will be considering it as L2%. So the same assumption I am taking, that I am considering 1 kg of fuel. So I have to see, because in this loss I am considering the amount of hydrogen present in the fuel. So if I am considering 1 kg of fuel, I have to check how much amount of hydrogen is present in this 1 kg of fuel. So I am assuming it as H2 kg. Friends, generally the amount of hydrogen present in the fuel is given as percentage. Suppose the amount of hydrogen in fuel is 10%, so you can say that in 100 kg of fuel you will have 10 kg of hydrogen. So accordingly you can calculate for 1 kg of fuel. As I have already told you in my previous video, that water forms in a combustion equation with the relation this one, 2H2 plus O2, that is 2H2O. This is a balanced chemical equation, and this is the combustion equation for hydrogen. So from here you can say, since the atomic weight of hydrogen is 1, so H2 means 2 into 1, that is 2 kg, and multiplied by 2, that is 4 kg. So 4 kg of hydrogen is burnt to form 2H2O, that is 18. 2 into 1, 2 plus 16, that is atomic weight of oxygen. So 18 multiplied by 2, 36 kg of water is getting produced. So from combustion of 4 kg of hydrogen, 36 kg of water is getting produced. So from 1 kg of hydrogen, how much amount of water will be formed? So friends, using the simple unitary method, I can easily calculate the amount of water which will be formed from 1 kg of hydrogen, that is 36 divided by 4, 9 kg water. So if my 1 kg of fuel is having H2 kg of hydrogen, so 9 multiplied by H2, this much kg of water will be formed. Now as the water is released along with the flue gas, it reaches the outside atmosphere at an ambient temperature of TA, and there it gets condensed. And friends, do remember that the water vapor which leaves from the combustion chamber condenses outside, and whenever water vapor gets condensed, the latent heat of condensation is released, and that heat will not be available in the combustion chamber. So the heat loss that is linked with the formation of water because of the hydrogen present in the fuel can be divided into two parts. So the temperature of water vapor first reduces from TF to TA, and in this reduction from TF to TA, some amount of energy will be released to the atmosphere, and then the water vapor condenses, and with this condensation the energy is further released in the form of latent heat of condensation. So what we have to know here, that the latent heat of water corresponding to the partial pressure is 584 kilocalorie per kg. So first the temperature of water will reduce from TF to TA, and then it will get condensed to water. So accordingly the heat lost will be divided in two parts, that is heat lost as the temperature of water vapor reduces to TA from TF, that is ambient temperature, from flue gas temperature, and then the heat released when the water vapor condenses to water. So the heat energy released as the temperature of water vapor is reduced from TF to TA will be given by the general formula, that is M into S into delta T. So M is the mass of the water, S is the specific heat, and delta T is the temperature difference. So how much amount of water is getting produced from H2 kg of hydrogen? I have already calculated that 9 multiplied by H2 kg of water will be formed. So this is my value of M. So the heat energy released from TF to TA will be given by M multiplied by S multiplied by delta T. So value of M will be 9 into H2. Specific heat of water is Cp, and the temperature difference will be TF minus TA, and the heat lost as the water vapor gets condensed into water will be given by M into L, where M is the mass and L is the latent heat. So the mass of the water is 9 into H2 as I have already calculated, and latent heat of the water corresponding to the partial pressure is 584. Now I will rewrite it as, I will take 9H2 common, and here left 584, and here Cp into TF minus TA will be left, and I will arrange it accordingly like this, and I will call it as my equation 1. Now heat input. For heat input I am assuming 1 kg of fuel. So if GCV is the gross calorific value of the fuel, so the heat input for 1 kg of fuel will be 1 multiplied by GCV, because I am assuming 1 kg of my fuel. So it will reduce to GCV. This will be my equation 2. So the L2 percentage, which is nothing but the heat lost due to formation of water from hydrogen present in fuel, will be the ratio of 1 and divided by equation 2 multiplied by 100. So ultimately my equation reduces to 9 into H2, 584 plus Cp TF minus TA divided by GCV. So friends, this is my formula for L2%, which is the loss due to formation of water. Basically friends, I have realized, if you are not having the concept that how the things are derived, so it is very difficult to remember all the things. So friends, I hope that the concept of this L2 and the formula and the complete derivation and the concept is now very much clear to you all.